Hello and welcome to Simple Truths. We are in a brand new quarter and we are going to study the great controversy. Today is lesson one. If you'd like to follow along, grab a quarterly from your local Seventh-day Adventist church. You can also go online to ssnet.org. At the table with me for this very informative, very important discussion, Chuck Austin on my right. Chuck, how are you?
Good. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
You ready for this study?
Yes. This quarter is going to be an interesting study, an exciting study.
When I learned what the topic was, mm-hmm. I got excited. In fact, as soon as I could get my hands on it, I'm like, all right, which ones do I want to be involved in? All of them would be the answer.
Yeah.
Joe Engelhorn is here too, my friend and co-worker.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. Happy to be here. Love this topic.
Yes.
It's so important.
Yeah.
We need to know what this lesson is going to teach.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, where does sin originate? Why do we have sin in our world? What is going on, mm-hmm. you know, today behind the scenes? And this is really going to point that out. Our memory text for this week is found in Revelation 12, 7 and 8. And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. Joe, before we get started in this study, would you please pray?
I will. Father in heaven, we are so excited for this study. The great controversy is full of somewhat terrifying things, but most of all, triumphant
Amen.
Things. Lord, we know you have total control. You have shared with us through your word what is ahead of us. And we just pray that the Holy Spirit will be with us now and then.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, again, we ask that the Holy Spirit be with us right now. We pray that the words shared here, the thoughts come from him. And we also pray that those that are watching are blessed as we know we will be. We thank you, Lord, for all the things you do mm-hmm. in our lives to bless us, to help us, to protect us. We thank you in all things in your son's name. Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Joe.
You're welcome.
Well, lesson one and day one, Sabbath, the war behind all wars. And I'll read just the first couple lines here. If God is so good, why is the world so bad? How can a God of love allow so much evil to exist? Why do bad things happen to good people? When I read that, I was reminded of something I read years ago where a son had been murdered. And the parent was obviously in great grief and wondering, where was God? You know, where is God? Where was he when my son was being killed? And the answer was in the same place that he was when his son was killed.
Mm. That's beautiful.
On the throne, in heaven, in control. Mm-hmm. It may not look like it today, mm-hmm. but God is in control.
Yep. Yep.
And we just have to hang in there a little bit longer.
Right. And that's a, you know, those couple of questions you asked, those questions are asked by a lot of people out there when they see
yeah.
bad things happen in their life.
I think even good faith believing Christians,
oh, true.
I know I at times have thought, really, Lord? Really, why? But then you have to step back and say, I don't know the answer to this,
right.
but God, you're in control.
What helps me is knowing that if there is a grief-stricken moment or time, that God is just as or more so grief-stricken when mm-hmm. he sees one of his children hurting or sees, you know, someone killed. This was not what he wanted for us. And
right.
that gives me a lot of comfort. And I you know, the words, why me, I try to flip that and go, why not me?
Yeah,
right.
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
yeah.
So. Why not me? Wow, Joe.
Right?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Because after all, we are residents of a Mm-hmm. sin-stricken planet.
We're part of this human race here on Earth,
yeah.
and
why
bad
not
things
me?
Happen.
Wow.
Yeah.
The rest of that first paragraph, in this week's lesson, we will explore the age-long conflict between good and evil, beginning with Lucifer's rebellion in heaven. We will examine the origin of evil and God's long-suffering in dealing with the sin problem. Long-suffering, his extreme patience. He is so patient. God is a God of incredible love. His very nature is love. All of his actions are loving. Love can never be forced, coerced, or legislated. And I think we've all heard little, you know, analogies of a marriage, for instance. You can't force a spouse to love you.
Yeah.
And a good spouse would not want that kind of love.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And dropping down to the very bottom of Sabbath, the last paragraph, looking at the world through the lens of God's love in the light of the great controversy between good and evil, this reassures each of us that right will triumph over wrong and will do so forever.
Mm-hmm.
That's a promise we can hang on to.
Mm-hmm. You know, that second question in the sentence made me think of this as you were reading some other stuff. How can a God of love allow so much evil to exist? And sadly to say that the evil exists because of choices that our parents made originally. And God could have just destroyed them at that moment. But his love for them allowed them to live on. And he provided a way for them to be restored in a relationship with him in the fact of his own death, his son's death. You know, and so like I said, for me, it's like when I start questioning God of how can you let these terrible things happen, I have to go, wait a second. Mm-hmm. I have to go back to the cross. When I see the cross, I'm like, wait a second. If God was so indifferent to my situation, he wouldn't cared and he wouldn't have let his son come and die for us.
Yeah.
So again, Amen. the fact that God allows even evil to happen is because he is a God of love. Because if he said, okay, I'm going to stop, you know, these people over here from doing drugs, or I'm going to stop these people from abusing these people, then what he's done, he's taken away their freedom of choice.
That's right.
And love allows freedom of choice, even if they make wrong choices.
Yeah.
But God can intervene and still turn things around. And he does give opportunity. And nobody's going to be able to say when this is all over, oh, Lord, you didn't try hard enough to reach me. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
No. In fact, we're told that every tongue confess and every knee will bow.
Amen.
And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Lord.
They'll know that in their heart.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right.
Yep.
All right. Moving on to Sunday. Joe, I'm going to have you reread 7 and 8, but I want you to add verse 9.
Okay.
And the question, and actually there's several questions here, so as you read, be thinking about the answers to these questions. What does this passage reveal about the freedom existing in heaven and the origin of evil? And when Lucifer rebelled, in what ways could God have responded? Joe.
Okay. And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
So what does this passage reveal about the freedom in heaven? What do you think, Joe?
Well, first of all, God could have easily exterminated Satan and his angels right there.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that he allowed freedom and choice, he came up with an alternative.
Mm-hmm.
Satan did not belong there anymore. He could not live there anymore. That kind of dissension and that, an easy word for who everyone knows, that kind of backstabbing attitude and that kind of thing did not belong there.
Yeah.
So he had to be sent away, but he wasn't killed.
Yeah.
You know, and he was created. So the creator could have taken his life away and his angels. So, you know, it just shows the incredible mercy, the incredible love of God, and also his name and reputation needed to be restored.
Amen.
So this was one, you know, way.
The second half of that question, what does it tell us of the origins of sin or where sin came into being? Chuck, thoughts on that?
Yeah, obviously the origins is Lucifer choosing to rebel against God. Here's the highest created being in the universe. The Bible tells us in Ezekiel that he was a covering cherub.
Yeah.
Which covering cherub, when you understand the sanctuary, you understand that he was one that stood next to God. And so it's like he had the highest position that God could give any created being in the universe, and he wasn't satisfied with that. He wanted God's position. I want your place.
It just wasn't enough for him,
right.
You know, which is incredible to me.
Yep.
He wanted that adoration, right? He wanted that worship for himself. He saw God receiving it, and he wanted it.
Yeah. It's sort of the problem with humanity as well. You know, Satan was an angel, you know, but it's self. It's whenever we let self rise above everything else, and that's what Satan did. Yeah. He concentrated on self instead of the goodness of God.
Yeah.
You know? And we do that too.
Well, let that be a lesson to us.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. To never take our eyes off. And if we feel those little whispers, well, the easiest way to get rid of those is, well, you can say, Satan, get behind me.
Right.
Jesus, you know, in Jesus' name, I rebuke you. You have no business in my life. You have no place in this place. We have all those at our, you know, available to us.
Right, all those promises.
So powerful. Mm-hmm. The second question there, in what ways could God have responded? We've kind of hinted on that. For instance, God could have annihilated him on the spot and served as a warning for others. Why didn't he do that?
So good question. So when Joe was sharing all the things about God and his love and stuff about why he didn't, why he allowed Satan to live, the word that came to me, my mind too, was it shows the wisdom of God as well. How can that be
good
wise
point.
For God to allow somebody as evil as this to live? And the wisdom is because if, like you said, Jeanette, if he would have annihilated Satan on the spot, the other angels watching would have thought what?
He proved his point.
We better toe the line, and we better be step in line, because if we don't, that's going to happen to us too. And now they're going to serve him out of fear rather than out of love.
Yeah.
So God, in his wisdom, had to allow things to go on so people could see the contrast of following Lucifer, who became Satan's ways, or following God's ways.
Yeah. Do you think, I mean, we don't know, it's pure speculation, or maybe it's not. Do you think Lucifer was offered redemption and forgiveness? Do you think God tried to reason with him and plead with him?
I think he did. I think Jesus himself probably went to him and tried to show him what would happen if he continued on that path. I can't imagine that with the compassion and mercy of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that they wouldn't have tried to bring him back.
And I agree with you, knowing the character of God, and that, like we read here, that God is love, you know, his very nature is love, we read there. And with him having that love, it would just make sense that he would have done everything he could to try to help to reason with Lucifer, that Lucifer, where you're going, is not going to end up in a good place. You know,
when you think about it, you know, Father in his throne, Jesus by his side, Lucifer, you know, there, that would feel like a brotherhood, right? Jesus and Lucifer, that they would be close. And we don't know how long Lucifer existed before this happened. It could have been
millions.
Millions
of years.
And so there would have been a relationship. You know, even if it was just a few years. Think about my relationship with you. I didn't know you 4 years ago.
Right.
But now we've grown closer. We're good friends. Yeah. We work together. So there must have been, you know, a relationship that, you know, Jesus would have wanted to save.
Amen.
Yeah,
Amen.
Exactly. And whether it was years or thousands of years or millions of years that Lucifer was in existence before he rebelled, think about what it's going to be. And you say, here the Father has this love for Lucifer, standing right next to him in his throne, you know, even though he loves all of his creation, that he has this great love for Lucifer. And at the very end, he's going to have to destroy Lucifer. Think of the pain that's going to bring God's heart, you know, that he realizes that this must happen for the good of the universe.
Yeah.
How I wish it could have been so much different.
Yes.
Just like David with Absalom, when Absalom was killed. You know, oh, you know, my son, would I have been the one that had died for thee, you know? And praise the Lord that God was willing to die for us. Jesus would only die for us, that we could have the opportunity to know him and live with him for all eternity.
Incredible that that plan was in place just in case.
Even before.
They knew.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Some people may ask, you know, well, why didn't God allow Lucifer to be part of that plan that he could repent and stuff. Well, here's the difference, at least my understanding as I read the Bible, is that Lucifer stood in all the glory of God because he stood next to God. He's seen all the glory of God. There's nothing more God could show him. And I believe, like you said, Joe, that he did plead with him, you know, as he saw him going off track. But we have never seen all the glory of God.
No.
So we still have an opportunity to have God's love revealed to us more and more so that we can make that decision. Like I said earlier, nobody's going to stand before the Lord someday and say, Lord, you didn't try for me. Because God's going to be able to show them. I don't know how he's going to do it at the end. He's going to give them their own little personal movie reel or whatever.
Maybe, yeah.
But he's going to show them how he reached out to them again and again and again and again and again.
Amen. Why didn't, and again, just as just speculation, want some conversation here, why didn't God create a whole separate realm where Satan and the fallen angels could live and never interfere with earth or never interfere with heaven again and just be off somewhere?
Yeah. Again, I think God's reputation was at stake, and the rest of the universe or universes or how, you know, whatever, would have seen that. And it would have seemed like a banishment of incredible punishment. Like, we'll put him in a separate place, an island of sorts, so that he no longer has any freedom. And then again, that contradicts what we know about God's character, that he gives choice. He's a God of freedom and a God of love. So that, I think, would have been very confusing to the rest of the universe.
Plus, I think also that, you know, that if Satan and all of his angels and stuff were allowed in a place that where they were isolated but able to live, we know what sin has done to us and to this world, and the pain and woe and misery and heartache has brought. And they would have not known joy. They would have not known peace. They would have only known misery and abuse and people controlling people who Satan may have been controlled and his own demons that were under him and stuff. And there would have been heartache and pain. And God doesn't want to see any of his creation suffer with heartache and pain. Rather to destroy them.
Satan.
Rather to destroy him than allow him to live in eternity with suffering and pain.
I kind of think they might have destroyed each other eventually.
Yeah, it's very
because,
possible.
You know,
very
right?
possible.
Well, ultimately, God uses loyal angels to escort Lucifer and the other group of angels. We're told one third, right? Mm-hmm. We don't know how many, but a third of the angels were convinced in this war, this gossip campaign.
That shows you how deceptive Satan's lies were, and how convincing they were that here is angels that were in the presence of God and worked in his government in the universe, and yet Lucifer, who became Satan, was able to convince them that he had a better plan of who should be in charge than God, and they bought into it. You know, it's amazing.
That's amazing, because they saw the glory of God also.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then we think we can beat him.
I know, right?
I got this.
Exactly. That's why the Bible tries to share with us over and over again. Our only safety is in Jesus.
Yes.
Our only safety is... Yes. I mean, it may not say it in those exact words, but it says it in that message over and over again in the Bible.
Amen. Well, mid-page on Sunday, the question is asked, what went on in the mind of this angelic being called Lucifer that led to his rebellion? So, Chuck, if you would read Ezekiel 28:12-15, Joe, Isaiah 14:12-14, and then we'll talk.
Okay. Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre and say to him, thus says the Lord God, you were the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. The sardius, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day you were created. until iniquity was found in you. I think we need to understand for when the very beginning it says, Son of Man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre and say to him, oh, wait, this is about the king of Tyre. This isn't about Satan or Lucifer. But we need to understand that oftentimes God will use another object or another person in reference to Satan, because that person, unfortunately, is exhibiting the characteristics of Satan. And we know the king of Tyre was not a good king. And so we know it's not the king of Tyre literally, because it says you were in Eden. Mm-hmm. You were perfect when you were created. Well, obviously, the king of Tyre, as all of us, were not perfect when we were created. The king of Tyre was never in the Garden of Eden, because we only have, from the Bible, only three people were in the Garden of Eden. So obviously, this couldn't be talking about mm-hmm. the king of Tyre. It was talking, mm-hmm. and he says you were in the anointed cherub. We know that Lucifer was an anointed cherub.
And the setting, I mean, just as I've heard the verse before, obviously, many times, but as you're reading it again, what a beautiful setting. Mm. Perfect until iniquity was found in him. Yes. All right, Joe, Isaiah 14, 12 to 14.
Okay. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Well, there's your answer. What was going on in his mind?
Right.
It's all about me.
Me, 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 me. He had an eye problem.
Self, self, self.
He did have an eye problem. He wanted more.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. He was called Son of the Morning, for goodness sakes.
Yes,
you know?
Yes. Yeah. Just below the middle page here, that paragraph, God did not create a devil. He created a being of dazzling brightness named Lucifer. This angelic being was created perfect. Included in his perfection was freedom of choice, a fundamental principle of God's government, which runs by love, not coercion. And of course, Chuck, you mentioned that mm-hmm. already. Sin originated with Lucifer in heaven itself. So there's the answer.
Mm-hmm.
How did it start? Where did it start?
Iniquity was found in you, Lucifer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And yet you were perfect until then. So how could a perfect, I don't know, right?
The next sentence, I think, explains it.
Okay. There is no logical explanation why this perfect angel should have allowed pride and jealousy to take root in his heart and grow into rebellion against his creator. There is no logical explanation.
Yeah, because if you explain it, you could excuse it.
My thought is that's what the time with Christ will be about, you know, answering our questions about what happened here.
Amen.
In the story of the great controversy, there's going to be long periods of time where we get to sit at his feet and just ask away.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then we'll have our answer.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know?
And think of the testimony that we'll have too. You know, really, mm-hmm. when we get to heaven, the testimony that we'll have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
My mom shared a dream with me not too long ago. I visited on my birthday weekend. And she said, do you remember that dream? I said to her, Mom, didn't you have a dream about this and this? She goes, no, the dream went like this. And she's in heaven, living in a beautiful little cottage that has no windows, but open way, you know,
mm-hmm.
windows, but no glass.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a knock on her door, and she opened the door, and it was Jesus. And Jesus said, would you come with me? There's some people that want to hear your testimony. And Mom said to herself, in the dream, she said, my testimony? You know, I really, what do I have? We survived planet Earth. Mm-hmm. We had faith in Jesus. We lived to tell about it. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be a huge testimony.
Oh, yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. All right, Chuck, would you read the last paragraph on Sunday?
Okay, it says, although God bore long with Lucifer, he could not allow him to spoil heaven with his rebellion. And then this last part here is from the book Great Controversy. It says, the heavenly councils pleaded with Lucifer. The Son of God presented before him the greatness, the goodness, and the justice of the Creator, and the sacred, unchanging nature of his law. God himself had established the order of heaven, and in departing from it, Lucifer would dishonor his Maker and bring ruin upon himself. But the warning, given in infinite love and mercy, only aroused a spirit of resistance.
There it is.
Yep. It didn't humble him. It actually caused him to resist even more.
Wow.
It does sound like the human condition. You know, how many times has a parent tried to save their child from the clutches of, you know, drugs or something else that is bringing ruin and still gets resistance?
And it says the heavenly councils pleaded with Lucifer.
Yeah.
So it wasn't just a one-on-one.
There are
multiple beings pleading with him.
Well, two-thirds of the angels did not follow him. So can you imagine two-thirds of the angels? I can't imagine how many angels are in heaven.
Yeah. Right? I'm sure there's millions.
Right.
Because in other places in the Bible it says thousands and upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. So that's in the millions already.
Yeah.
How many millions? I don't know.
That's a lot of angels.
A lot of angels trying to talk him out of, you know, doing what he was
doing.
Don't go there.
Well, unless there's any more comments, we'll go to Monday.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm dropping down to about the third line there, the first paragraph. Satan's pride ripened into open rebellion. He accused God of being unjust and unfair. He infected the angels with his doubts and his accusations. Just yesterday, I recorded an episode on Women in the Word with your wife, Alta, and Donna. So the three of us talked about the topic of gossip. And it was brought up on that program that, you know, even gossip, the very origin of gossip, started in heaven. It was Satan gossiping to the others, just a little whisper. It probably wasn't even too bad to begin with, right?
Yeah.
Just a little, what do you think? Do you think he's, but that's, you know, gossip started in heaven with Lucifer, and we still suffer from it today.
That's a great point.
Yeah.
Like you said, and I can just see Satan, just Lucifer at that point, just throwing out, like say, little questions, just putting in their mind reasons for doubt.
A little tidbits.
Yeah, little
tidbits. Yep. Yeah. Did you hear the master say this? I don't know, is that right?
Or
it, like you said, it could have been very, very gentle.
Yep, very subtle.
Until it wasn't.
Yep, yep.
And we're told it got so bad that he had to be let go.
He was able to hide his agenda for a while.
For a while.
Well, let's see how convincing Satan was. Joe, would you read Revelation 12:4?
Yes. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven, referring to the angels, and threw them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born.
Until really last 5-6 years, I've always envisioned swords and fists and battle, you know, and perhaps there was eventually, perhaps they physically had to be removed. But the war that I think more so this war was a campaign of words.
Yes, yes.
So when war broke out in heaven, the angels had to decide, would they follow Jesus or Lucifer? What was the nature of this war in heaven? Was it a physical war or a war of ideas or both? We don't know the details, but the conflict was physical enough that Satan and his angels eventually were cast out, and a place was not found for them in heaven any longer.
Mm-hmm. Just real quickly, some people might, you know, be new to the book of Revelation stuff, and it says, his tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. How do you get that's Satan, and you know, the stars are angels, you know? Well, again, in the book, especially in the book of prophecy, but other places in the Bible too, there's a lot of symbolism. Mm-hmm. And so the Bible explains itself. Mm-hmm. And so who's the his? We go back to the verse before that. It says the dragon. We know, we go up Revelation 12, 7 through 9. It says the dragon is Satan. And then the stars, we can go to Revelation 1, and it talks about stars being angels. When Jesus was holding the 7 stars in his hands, it says those were the angels.
Mm-hmm.
And then the tail, Isaiah chapter 9, it actually says that the prophet who tells lies, he is the tail. The one who is honorable, he is the head.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the tail reference to? Lies.
Lies.
And Satan told lies. Like you said, he threw little doubts, little questionings.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Joe, did you have a thought?
No, I was just fascinated by what Chuck was sharing.
Well, mid-page on Monday, it asks, what fundamental principle in the great controversy do these verses teach us? And so there's a little bit of reading here. Joe, if you would start, and then Chuck and I have some to read as well.
Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Mm-hmm. Then Moses stood in the entrance of the camp and said, whoever is on the Lord's side, come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves together to him.
Okay. And check Joshua 24:15 and 1 Kings 18.
Okay, Joshua 24:15. And I love this verse. And if it seems evil to you, this is Joshua speaking, and if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Love that.
I do too. I do too. We have a little plaque for that actually in our house. In 1 Kings 18, verse 20.
And 21.
And 21, yes. So Ahab sent for all the children of Israel and gathered the prophets together on Mount Carmel. And Elijah came to the people and said, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. And if Baal, follow him. But the people answered, not a word.
And I will read Revelation 22, 17. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. So the question, what fundamental principle in the great controversy do these verses teach us? Responsibility, allegiance. I hear an invitation to choice.
Yes, and making choices wisely.
Yes, yes.
Carefully.
Yes.
That was a theme I got through it too. Yeah, freedom of choice. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Need to choose.
I hear a call to stewardship. Mm-hmm. And commitment to righteousness. Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts on that?
There's so many good thoughts there that in all those verses. That, you know, the one in Genesis 2 where it says that the day that you eat of it, you shall die. And we know that Adam did not die the day he ate of that fruit. You know, he and Eve lived for some time after that. But the death Nell began to be lived out in his life. He began to experience aging and death. Mm-hmm. And he did die spiritually that day. Mm-hmm. He died spiritually because at that time he was in harmony with the Creator. Yeah. But after that, he was expelled from the Garden of Eden and had to be not with face-to-face with God anymore. In fact, in Exodus it tells us that when Moses wanted to see the glory of the Lord said, you know, no one can see my face and live because of the sinful condition they were in now. Mm-hmm. And so, in a sense, Adam did die that day. He died spiritually.
I heard one preacher speak on a day is 1,000 years, as 1,000 years is a day to the Lord. Mm-hmm. And that perhaps when he said you'll die within, you know, that the day that he was actually speaking within a thousand years.
Within.
And he only lived to be 930, so.
There you go.
It's possible.
I can't even imagine what it must have been like for Adam to have walked with Jesus in the garden and just conversed together and Jesus sharing, you know, thoughts about his creation and sharing his love for Adam and Eve, and then to have that gone.
Taken. Just gone.
It's like when we lose a beloved parent and we no longer can walk with them or sit with them. You know how it affects us.
Yes.
I can't imagine what that was like.
And same with the, you know, timelines. We have no idea how many days, weeks, years, many years. How many, you know, how long did Adam and Eve enjoy that experience with Jesus in the garden? Until they were cast out.
Yeah.
Joe, would you read the last paragraph on Monday?
Sure. When God created humanity, he embedded deep within our brains the ability to think, to reason, and to choose. The essence of our humanness is our ability to make moral choices. We are not mere robots. We were created in God's image, distinct from the animal creation, in our ability to make moral choices and live by eternal spiritual principles. After Lucifer's rebellion in heaven and after the fall, God has called his people to respond to his love and be obedient to his commands by choosing to serve him.
Beautiful. Yeah. At the bottom of the page, it asks, what lessons can we learn from the battle in heaven that relates to our own personal battle with evil? And so I'd, you know, just suggest that you ask yourself that question and dwell on it, pray about it. If Satan was able to deceive these righteous, holy, heavenly beings, what does this say about his evil attempts to deceive us? Mm-hmm. We don't stand a chance without Jesus.
Amen.
We just don't.
Yep. Yep.
Moving on to Tuesday, planet Earth becomes involved. This is so critically important. When God created the Earth, he created it perfect. The Bible says that he saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. There was no stain of sin or evil anywhere, but he gave Adam and Eve the same freedom of choice he had given to Lucifer. He didn't want robots on earth any more than he wanted robots in heaven. In fact, he went out of his way to make this freedom clear. He planted a tree in the garden and called it the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I'm going to stop right there and just ask you to talk a little bit, check on this. Why the tree? Why a test?
Yeah. So good question. So in my thought that he could have, people would say, why did he even put that tree of knowledge of good and evil there? You know what? We would have never had this sin problem. But then the question is, would we have ever known if Adam and Eve were truly loyal to God, or were they only loyal to God because they had no opportunity to even make a choice separate from God? You know, mm-hmm. It's like I've shared in some of my Bible study students, I said, so say we have this bowl, and this bowl is filled with red marbles. And it is, I mean, it's like, it's a big bowl. It's got like 1,000 red marbles in there. And I tell the person, you know what? Pick any color of marble that you want to pick. Well, what color are they going to pick? Red, because they have no choice. They have no choice mm-hmm. to make a decision on their own other than one I've already programmed them to make.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, God had to give them the opportunity, and for the onlooking angels and stuff to see that they had an opportunity to choose separately, just like Lucifer chose to choose separately.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Will we always have freedom of choice?
Personally, I believe we will.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't think God's going to ever take that away.
Yeah.
But it's interesting, the book Nahum says that affliction shall never rise the second time.
Yeah.
And I personally believe the reason why that is because we're going to be reminded of something.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it'll never rise a second
mm-hmm.
time.
Mm-hmm.
And what's that reminder? There's going to be
the
one
scars.
Being. There's one being in the universe mm-hmm. that will not have a perfect body.
The scars. Mm-hmm.
And that's Jesus. He's the only being that will not have a perfect body. He'll have the scars. And that'll remind us what sin cost.
Yeah.
It cost the death of our Creator.
Yeah.
The one that loved us more than any other. The more that our parents could love us. That Creator loved us that much that he's willing to die for us.
Yeah.
And we will never want to do anything to ever hurt our Creator again.
Amen. Amen.
Gives me chills.
I know.
Me too. I've had a hard time getting that out.
Yeah. Yeah. The only scars in heaven
will
be on our Savior.
That's why we love that song so much.
Amazing. Amazing. All right. Where are we? Okay. I'm going to read... Again, we're on Tuesday, dropping down to the fourth paragraph. When Eve and later Adam made that choice, they opened a door that God wanted to keep closed, keep forever closed. It was the doorway to sin, the doorway to suffering, heartache, sickness, and death. So, mm-hmm. Joe, if you would read Genesis 3, 1 to 3, I'll grab Romans 3, and Chuck, you have Romans 5.
Okay.
Now, the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, 'You shall not eat of every tree of the garden?'" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, 'You shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die.'" First of all, did God ever say they couldn't touch it?
Mm-hmm. Not that I see.
Not in the Word.
It's not recorded in the Word.
It's not recorded in the Word. So, you know, I read somewhere that Eve added that, and why?
So in my mind, it already shows that Eve had already got distorted in what God's requirement was.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Oh, such a good point.
Mm-hmm. So I'm glad you're here because I'm wondering about that.
All right, the question is, what do the following verses have in common? So keeping in mind what you just read, okay. Joe, I have Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And Chuck, you have Romans 5:12.
Okay. Can I come in on Romans 3:23?
Absolutely.
First? So a lot of times people will use, what is the definition of sin? And they'll go to 1 John 3:4. Sin is the transgression of the law. Uh-huh. Sin is lawlessness, depending on what version you look at. And it's true. Sin is, the Bible's a book of truth. So yes, sin is transgression. It's going against the law of God. So that's what sin is, opposing the law of God. But I like this Romans 3:23, because in my mind, it gives us a second definition.
Let me read it again.
Go ahead.
For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God.
And so what is sin? It's falling short of the glory of God.
Yeah.
And what is the glory of God? When we go back to Exodus chapter 33 and 34, we see that Moses wanted to see the glory of God. And God revealed his glory to him. What was it? It was his character. And so when we sin, what are we doing? We're falling short of the character of God. And that's what he wants for us. That's what he wants to restore us back to. And that's what he's working in each of us.
Yeah.
That as we cooperate with him, he's restoring his character back in us.
I love that.
And you notice I said that he is restoring it.
I
can't make it happen.
Yeah.
Only God can make it. All I can do is come to him and allow him, give him permission to work in my life.
That old 55 Chevy out in the field isn't going to restore itself.
That's right.
It cannot,
right?
Right?
Amen.
It needs a restorer.
Amen. Very good. I like that.
I remember that too.
Romans 5:12.
Okay. Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all sinned.
Yeah. What is the ultimate result of sin that plagues the entire human race? It's separation from God, mm-hmm. eternal mm-hmm. separation. And as Adventists, we don't believe in eternal hellfire. We do believe in a hellfire that will destroy.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
We don't believe it will burn forever, causing agony and screaming and eternal pain. We don't believe a loving God would do that.
Right. And we know that the Bible tells us, especially New Testament, I found at least three times where it says that God is no respecter of persons, that God does not play favorites, that God loves everyone. And so God is saying to each and every person who's ever walked on this earth that I want you to be with me for eternity.
Yeah.
And so please listen to me. Be willing to come to me. I can take that sin out of your life. I can give you forgiveness of that sin. I can give your slate clean. And we can enjoy eternal fellowship. I want you to be there with me. Because you know what? There's nobody like you. You know? There's nobody like Jeanette.
Yeah.
There's nobody like Joe. And so if you're not there, Chuck can't take your place.
Yeah.
You know, only Jeanette can take Jeanette's place. Only Joe can take Joe's place. Yeah. Only Chuck can take Chuck's place.
Amen.
God's saying, I don't want you to miss out on this.
Amen.
So, so again, it just tells me the great love of God, that he is doing everything he can, because he doesn't say, well, you know what? I'm going to have at least, you know, a couple million in heaven and stuff. So if the rest of them don't make it, no, that's not God's attitude at all.
I heard Cherie Peters once say, if God had a refrigerator, your picture would be on it.
Oh.
And I just think of all the things I used to put on my fridge, all my kids' artwork and their school photo, and it's like, if God had a refrigerator, our class picture would be up there.
And I can so identify with that idea that, you know, someone can't replace someone else. Mm-hmm. When a parent loses a child, they may have 10 other children, but none of those children can replace the child they've lost. And it isn't showing preference for that child. It's just factual.
Amen.
Each child is individual. You love them equally, but often in different kind of ways because of who they are.
That's right.
You know?
And not everybody, you know, love language.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has, there's not multiple love languages. There's a few, though.
Yes.
Some people like to be hugged and touched, and others, please don't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, others can take a strong, healthy criticism, and others would crumple. You have to know the language.
So if a parent really knows their child, the parent shows love in the way that the child can receive
it. Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Right.
The very bottom of Tuesday here, at its very core, sin is rebellion against God. Sin separates us from God, and since God is the source of life, separation from God leads to death. It also leads to worry, anxiety, sickness, and disease. The suffering in our world is ultimately the result of living in a sin-ravaged planet. This certainly does not mean that every time we suffer, we have sinned. It does mean that every one of us is affected by living on this planet. Mm-hmm. You were talking about sin, and my mom, several years ago, shared something that she had kind of, it just come on her, and sin is like missing the mark. You're an archer, you have your bow and arrow, and you have a target, and you let go, and it misses. Sin is missing the mark. So what do? You grab it and you back up and you try again and you try again. So yes, sin is serious. Mm-hmm. It's a serious problem. And people mm-hmm. with sin still in their life will not inherit eternal life. Right. But it's also very easy to go to God and say, forgive me. Right. Help mm-hmm. me do better. Right. Mm-hmm. Right. All right, let's move on to
That's a humbling experience, because a lot of times yes. pride wants to get in the way. I can handle it. I can take care of it.
That's so true. We're going to skip the reading because just for time, we're going to drop mm-hmm. down to the middle of the page, mm-hmm. and it asks, what do these verses tell us about the immensity of Christ's suffering on the cross? And let's see, Joe, you have Hebrews 2:9, Chuck, Galatians 3:13.
But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone.
Yes. Wow.
Yep. Good comment on that.
Yes.
So when this says that he might taste death for everyone, what is that talking about? Which death is that? And that, I use this verse with my Bible study students. I said, because I'm sharing the idea of a first death and second death, because I came out of a church that believes, as you mentioned earlier, that believed you're going to burn forever and ever and ever and ever.
Right.
Yeah. If you're lost.
Me too.
Which yeah. obviously does not sound consistent with a loving God. And this is one of the verses I use. I mean, there's other verses I use as well, but this is one of the verses I use with my Bible study students to say, so if Jesus was going to taste the first death for everyone, does that make sense? Well, obviously it doesn't, because mm-hmm. unless Jesus comes, we're all going to taste the first death ourselves. Right. So the death that Jesus tasted was the second death. Yeah. And some people that have not maybe read or studied the Bible too much might not realize there actually talks about a second death in the Bible. Right. And it's only in about three or four different places, and it's all near Revelation. In Revelation, I think there's one other place other than Revelation. But this idea that there is a second death tells us that there is a cessation of life a second time, and that time it's final.
Yeah, as if they never existed.
As if they never existed, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Interesting.
So Galatians 3:13, you have me read?
Yes.
Okay. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Mm.
Mm. And I have 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Wow.
No, he became sin for us.
So that we could become the righteousness? So that we could,
the most incredible sacrifice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who of us would do that?
Yeah, right, exactly.
For somebody we loved, and yet Jesus did it for everyone. Mm. Mm-hmm. Knowing that many would not accept that gift. Mm-hmm. Right. Knowing that many would ridicule him and mock his very existence.
Right.
Getting ready, as we film this, we're getting ready for the Easter program at Gateway Church. And I'm going to sing Rise Again.
Mm-hmm. Ah.
And it's such strong lyrics. You know, go ahead, mock my name. My love for you is still the same.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some of the lyrics in that song. Jesus did it for those that he knew would never take that gift.
Right.
Just amazing.
Yeah. It shows his love.
So how big was his sacrifice? Profoundly big. Mm-hmm. Profoundly big. Mm-hmm. Let's move on to Thursday. Yeah. Our high priest. What Jesus did for us on the cross enables him also to intercede for us in heaven. Our resurrected Lord is our great high priest, providing everything we need to be saved, and to live in God's kingdom forever. So Joe, would you read Hebrews 4, 15, 16? Chuck, you have Hebrews 7.
Okay, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
And the question here, before you go on, Chuck, how do these verses give us assurance in a world of temptation, suffering, disease, and death?
Amen. And verse 25 of chapter 7 says, therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them.
All right.
I think the fact that he was tempted in all things as we are, but without sin, gives us such great hope. Yeah. Not that we can do what he did on our own, right, but we know he can do it.
Yeah. He did it for us.
Yeah. So
he did it in our place.
That is just a very hopeful scripture right there.
Yeah.
And the verse comes to my mind in regard to that one with Hebrews 4 that you read, Joe, about the idea that, you know, Jesus was tempted in all points like we are without sin. Is the first verse comes to my mind is 1 Corinthians 10:13, which says this: no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Hmm. In my mind, how I understand that verse is that God's going to make the way of escape. And how is the way of escape? Come to me, God says.
Yeah.
Come to me.
Yeah.
I am more powerful than any sin in your life. Come to me. Mm-hmm. So we can't say, well, God, that was a temptation that was so terrible. I couldn't resist it. You know, I had to give into it because, no, there's no temptation we can use that excuse.
I know, but sometimes I do think like that when I see chocolate in front of me. It's a tough one, but, you know.
Yeah. Are you dark chocolate or milk chocolate?
It doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. Oh.
I know dark chocolate is healthier.
Right.
But, you know.
Mm, yeah.
Milk chocolate tastes
so
good.
What do you call your bipartisan, huh?
Yes. Well, just bring it all on.
That's right. So how do these verses assure us? They remind us that Jesus is our compassionate high priest. Mm-hmm. Not only our high priest, but our compassionate. He understands our struggles. He offers grace and mercy to overcome our struggles. All we need to do is ask him.
You know, before he came to this earth, he most likely never knew or had a temptation up there in heaven.
Right.
Right? So, you know, having the master of all temptations challenging him mm-hmm. here on earth.
Yeah.
What an experience, horrible experience that had to be.
Yeah.
But he triumphed. Yeah. So that's the hope.
Amen.
The hope.
And people could say, well, you know, Jesus, I mean, it was already set up that he was going to come down here and was going to die on the cross and something. So it's like a no-brainer and stuff. I mean, it was all set up for him. No wonder he's going to be victorious. And if we had that kind of mindset, then what, in my mind, what Lucifer or Satan would be saying is, way of saying, God, you know, this is obviously a stacked deck here. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you've already got it worked out where he's going to win. I can't. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like playing a game of cards and stuff, and you've already dealt yourself the winning hand already. I mean, and so let me tell you, universe, this is what I tell you about God, how he's unfair, how he's da-da-da, you know. And he could just tell all the angels, all the holy beings stuff, you know. That's what I was trying to tell you about God, that he is unfair. Mm. But Jesus came at the risk of eternal loss. Eternal failure.
He was fully human as well as fully God.
He could have.
I mean, that's my thought. I didn't know if it was correct or not, but if you're fully human, then you are able to give in to temptation.
Well, if he was not able to give in to temptation, there's no risk.
That's right. There is no risk.
So what's the point?
Exactly. And in 1 Peter 2, it tells us that Jesus is our example. Well, if he didn't have any willingness or ability to be able to give in to temptation, then he's not our example, because we have the ability to give in to temptation.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So. That's right.
Such a good point.
The middle of page here on Thursday, it says, what is Christ's longing desire in the great controversy between good and evil? And that's John 17:24-26. I'm going to read that. Mm-hmm. John 17, 24, 26. I just love this, these verses. It really shows the heart of Jesus. Father, I desire that they also whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me, for you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you, and these have known that you sent me, and I've declared to them your name and will declare it, that the love with which you loved me may be in them and I in them. What a beautiful, beautiful few verses there. So what is Christ's longing desire in this great controversy?
It's for us to be restored in a relationship with him and be restored into a character like God's. And really quickly, I want to share that you read that. I love those verses you shared. And he says, I've declared to them your name. Well, obviously, they did not know that God's name was Yahweh. I mean, obviously, so it's not talking about your literal name. It's talking about your character. If I say that Jeanette has a good name, what am I saying? You have a good character, good reputation. Yeah. And it's interesting because earlier in that chapter, verse 4, Jesus says to his Father in this prayer, I have glorified you on the earth. I have finished the work which you've given me to do. Wait a second. You haven't even gone to the cross yet. So what work is it you finished? I finished revealing who you really are. Because the people had a distortion of what God was really like. And you see that as you go through the Gospels, especially the Jewish leadership. They were painting a different picture of what God was like to the people.
Mm-hmm. They were. Mm-hmm. Well, we're out of time. Yeah. Chuck, would you close us in prayer?
Sure, for sure. Father in heaven, thank you again, Lord, for your great love for us. In this great controversy that we are participants, we are not left to ourselves. Lord, you have provided everything we need to be victorious. You have given us all the tools we need, Lord. The greatest tool we need is choosing for you, Lord. And as we choose for you, Lord, you will finish in us the work that you have begun. Mm. Thank you for doing that. Mm. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Chuck. Just remember that Christ's longing desire in this great controversy is to have eternal relationship with you. He wants to live with us for eternity, not just give us a good life forever, but actually be a part of that life. So I encourage you to accept him today. If you've not done that, just pray, Jesus, come into my life. I want to know you more. He will reveal himself to you. God bless you. Thank you.